Oladejo Dosekun Memorial Lecture. And this is a hybrid ceremony where we have people inside this auditorium, the very first building in the University of Lagos called the Old Bridge Hall. And we also want to say that there are people joining us online because we still have to continue to be cognizant of the COVID-19 pandemic, and therefore we continue to follow the laid down protocol. The late Professor Felix Oladejo Dosekun was the first vice dean of the University of Lagos Medical School, as it was called then. And he was the first deputy provost of the College of Medicine, University of Lagos, as well as the second provost of the College of Medicine, University of Lagos. And we are proud to say that he is the first emeritus professor of the entire University of Lagos. Can we put our hands together? So this morning I will be anchoring this program. My name is Ademola Oremusu, and joining me is a very respected oral and mantis official surgeon in the name of Mr. Clement Oluwaruti, Dr. Clement Oluwaruti. A round of applause.
Good morning, friends, ladies and gentlemen. As has already been announced, we are here for a wonderful occasion, the 7th Felix Oladejo Dosekun Memorial Lecture at the Old Bridge Hall. The topic we'll be looking at this auspicious event is titled Medical Education in Nigeria, Challenges of Infrastructural Decay, and the person that will do justice to the topic I've just announced will be His Excellency, former Governor of the Lagos State, and currently the Honourable Minister of Works and Housing, in person of Babatunde, Raji, Fashola, S.A.N. Can we give him a round of applause, please?
When the procession comes into the auditorium, we will kindly request all of us to be standing. We will announce to you. But permit me to unofficially, we will do that officially, recognize the family of late Professor Oladejo Dosekun. Please a round of applause for the family. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. You are all welcome. You are all welcome. Thank you. So, today is the 8th of April, and it's the day after the World Health Day, which is the 7th of April. And yesterday we celebrated another World Health Day with a theme, the greatest wealth is health. That's why today is very auspicious, and it's important that we are gathered to look at the issue of health in Nigeria. Without being political, we want to say that it is quite possible for all, virtually all health needs to be met in the country if we did not have this infrastructural decay. So it's a day that we encourage everybody to please pay attention. We also have in our midst this morning the representative of Her Excellency, the wife of the governor of Lagos State, Dr. Mrs. Ijoke Sanwo-Olu. Let's applaud. So in a short while, the procession will be coming in, and I want to say that we are having in our midst this morning the top echelon of the two institutions within this premises, the College of Medicine, University of Lagos, and the Lagos University Teaching Hospital.
The beautiful thing about the medical profession is that many of those who practice the profession assume that everything they do is well understood by people outside. So there was a story of this old man who was admitted in one of the wards at the Lagos University Teaching Hospital. And on this particular day, one of our wonderful professors of neurology, Professor Oladejo, was doing a ward round with 20 residents and 50 house officers and another 50 students. So you can imagine the crowd on this one man. So after they had spoken about all the conditions and done all the tests, the man was watching the time. And after they had spoken for 1 hour, the man beckoned to the nurse, said, "Please tell my family to prepare my funeral ceremony." Said, "If my condition is such that they've been discussing me for 1 hour with all these people, then there's no hope. Let me just go and meet my leader." So this is the kind of thing that we see happening in the medical profession. We want to also recognize the youngest man coming into this auditorium. He happens to be the quantum chairman of the Court of Governors of the College of Medicine, University of Lagos, Chief Olafade Oyefor. He is just about 59 now, I think, a very young man. Let's appreciate him, Chief Olafade Oyefor. I want to recognize all the professors who are already inside the auditorium, and permit me as we take as many as we can see from here.
An elder scholar and a wonderful mentor in person of Professor Jessica Okubadio. Please give a round of applause. You're welcome. Also very close to us is our very own professor from the Department of Pediatrics, Professor Christy Okoroma. You're welcome. We have a lot to her. Also, I have Professor Olawale from the Department of Physiotherapy. Please write a lot to him also. You're welcome. Very close to him is one of us, the college management, in person of Mrs. Abosede Okola, you're welcome. The Chief Internal Auditor of the College of Medicine, University of Lagos.
Wonderful lecturers and people who are experienced in doing the compare work. Students, we recognize Dr. Donna C. Unesi, the round of applause for her, and Dr. Obi Fazer. Alright, so what's the... Thank you.
society, we can have the national anthem.
Spiritual and temporal, members of the 7th Felix Oladejo Dosekun Memorial Lecture Organizing Committee, distinguished guests, gentlemen of the press, our dear students, ladies and gentlemen, it gives me a great pleasure and honor to welcome you to this 7th Memorial Lecture of a great academic icon in the College of Medicine, University of Lagos in general, late Professor Felix Oladejo Dosekun. I congratulate all of us for the privilege of being alive and where to participate in this important and memorable program. Our late professor was born August 31st, 1922, and died on August 27th, 1996, at the age of 74 years. The College of Medicine of the University of Lagos was set up in 1962 by an Act of Parliament as a body corporate within the University of Lagos to train medical, dental, and other allied health professionals in sustaining healthcare delivery in Nigeria. As at today, the College of Medicine of the University of Lagos is the foremost medical school in Nigeria and has trained and graduated over 800 medical and allied medical professionals. Late Professor Felix Oladejo Dosekun was an irrepressible and tireless academic who, along with other staff, formed a matrix that ensured that this medical college was established on a very strong foundation in the early 1960s. He was the first lecturer from whom the first set of students received a lecture on a fateful morning in the first week of September 1964. He arrived at the classroom promptly at 8 a.m., smartly dressed in his brown bow tie and white short sleeve shirt, over a brown pair of trousers and a black pair of shoes. Late Professor Felix Oladejo Dosekun had an awesome charisma and a captivity power of eloquence, both of which he used to great advantage. He was versatile in knowledge that he could teach most subjects. Little wonder he obtained his degrees at the Trinity College, Dublin, in record time with distinction, bagging first-class honors in several subjects. This memorial lecture was conceived several years ago to immortalize the late Professor Felix Oladejo Dosekun, who pioneered medical education in Nigeria, the late elder scholar and administrator of high excellence, was the first pro-chancellor of the University of Calabar, and the second provost of the College of Medicine, University of Lagos, from the period 1969 to 1976. He was also the very first deputy provost of the College of Medicine from the period 1962 to 1969. And he was also the first vice dean of the University of Lagos Medical School. He was the first professor to give an inaugural lecture in the University of Lagos and the first professor emeritus in the University of Lagos and also the Bachelor of Ondo. The 6th Felix Dosekun Memorial Lecture was held in October 2018 with the theme, Man Know Thyself and Healing Will Be Granted, How Medical Science Knowledge Helps to Achieve the Fruit of the Womb. This lecture was delivered by another scholar, Professor Ladako Ashiru, who was there, and it was well attended. The late Professor Felix Oladejo Dosekun was no doubt an exceptional man who worked tirelessly for the growth and development of the great college, and he was referred to as the doyen of physiology and one of the indigenous professionals recruited by the then Honourable Minister of Health, Chief Dr. M.A. Majakodumi, and worked with zeal and passion to ensure that the College of Medicine of the University of Lagos is highly recognized as one of the best in the world. He displayed exceptional and robust leadership and commitment that could not be equated with no others in the history of the college. On this note, I would like to honorably welcome our guest lecturer, Honorable Minister of Works and Housing, His Excellency, Babatunde, Raji, Fashola, SN, who we lecture on an interesting topic, had medical education in Nigeria, the challenges of infrastructural building. Sir Chairman, sir, kindly permit me to say that the College of Medicine of the University of Lagos is very grateful to the Honourable Minister for accepting our invitation to deliver this lecture despite his busy schedule. Distinguished ladies and gentlemen, I invite you all to listen to this thought-provoking lecture. Thank you. God bless College of Medicine. God bless our great university students and Master of Arts and Education Pride, the most powerful university in Nigeria. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. Thank you to the Provost of the College of Medicine, University of Lagos, University of First Pro-Chancellor, Professor Felix Oladejo Dosekun, to give his welcome and address. Mr. Provost, sir.
The committee to deal with the problem, ably represented by Mrs. Ruda, I think. Former Permanent Secretary, Ministry of Establishment and Training, Lagos State. The Chairman of Education, Professor Luatu, ably represented by the Deputy Vice Chancellor of Academic and Research, Professor Luwole Mandelun. All past provosts present, the Chief Lecturer and Director of the group, all principal officers of the college, faculty deans, heads of department, distinguished alumni, distinguished public members of the late Professor Dosekun, I can recognize my classmate, Dr. Humbo Dosekun. Thank you. My Lord, great proud and Deborah, members of the 7th Deputy Memorial Lecture Organizing Committee, distinguished guests, gentlemen of the press, Committee of Wives of Lagos State Council, hereby present, our dear students, distinguished ladies and gentlemen. I'm very delighted to welcome you all to the 7th Felix Oladejo Dosekun Memorial Lecture. This lecture series, started in 2001, is an endeavor to immortalize the colossus, Professor Felix Oladejo Dosekun, the foundation vice dean of the University of Lagos Medical School, and the second provost of the medical school, which later became the College of Medicine of the University of Lagos. The college considers it worthwhile to recognize and honor its staff who have made outstanding contributions in medical education and biomedical research. Hence, it organizes memorial lectures in honor of the first and second provost of the college in the person of Professor Oladejo Dosekun and Professor Felix Oladejo Dosekun, respectively. The late Professor Dosekun, along with others, laid the strong foundation for medical education in Nigeria, for which the college has become known worldwide. Professor Doe, as it was fondly called by those of us who are students, mentees, and indeed by some of his colleagues at the College of Medicine, University of Lagos, had a brilliant and eventful academic career. I was a cundus in the physiological sciences. He endeared himself to the hearts of men by his unrelenting work ethics, his drive for excellence, and his keen interest development. Keeping in step with Professor's legacy, the college has made great strides in the pursuit of excellence in medical education and medical and biomedical research. The MBBS BDS curriculum has been reviewed by the Medical Education Development Unit of Lagos. We now have student-centered, problem-based, community-oriented, elective, and systemic curriculums. Spices. This curriculum is in line with the global best practice and has impacted positively on the quality of medical and dental students of the college. Now in training, we are proud to have students who can compare with their counterparts globally. A good number of senior and junior faculty members have trained in ethics of research and the art of craftsmanship. This momentum is sustained by linkages and collaboration between colleges, and top-notch research institutes and universities all over the world. It gives me great pleasure to state that there have been tremendous improvements in the quality and quantum of research being carried out. The college and the University of Lagos now derives a steady inflow of income from facilities and administrative costs of local and international grants. Some of these grants include medical education partnership in Nigeria, 2010 to 2015, building research and innovation in Nigeria Sciences, BRAINS, which is still on, U54 epigenomic biomarkers of HIV associated cancers in Nigeria, 2007-2022, post-graduate mobility scholarship in African medical students, 2014-2020, Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, IVON trials, IVON trials, 2020 and 2023, among others. Please permit me to use this opportunity to commend both senior and junior faculty members who are working relentlessly in sustaining the tempo of world-class biomedical research. Sustaining the standard of medical education and biomedical research in the college also requires that existing infrastructure be maintained and new ones acquired. So this is during his tenure as provost, initiated quite a few development projects. At that time, owing to the autonomy of the college, funds were released to the college directly from government, a privilege no other medical school enjoyed. The first set of students hosted, we have today, the new grade hall, and the students' complex, including the cafeteria, are legacies left behind by the late Professor. I can still hear his famous words reverberating in my ears, and I quote, "You must learn the language of your profession in order to excel whatever you do." Management under the leadership of past and present roles have leveraged on various networks to bridge the gap in funding development projects by reaching out to the alumni, corporate government, and the Lagos State Government. We are most grateful for the continuous contributions of the college. The contributions of the college has received in cash and in kind, which have been instrumental to revamping of existing structures and acquisition of new ones. Today we have as a special guest of honor, His Excellency Mrs. Solo, the First Lady of the Lagos State Governor, Dr. Ibiroke Songwun. We are aware that this is another homecoming for us. Your Excellency, your husband has proven over and over again to be an astute administrator and incident commander who has been at the front line of combating the coronavirus pandemic. We appreciate his gallant and selfless role he has been playing in keeping Lagos safe. We also thank him for contributing towards the $2 million endowment fund that has helped us tackle the problem with Scota by our neighbors. We are appealing to His Excellency to you once again to come to our rescue by donating the Macapolo bus that my village produces, which always is let's discuss with him, to meet with the needs of students who take part in community immersion programs within and outside Lagos State. Your Excellency, our premises in dire need of expansion. And I'm using this opportunity again to repeat our appeal to you, to the state government, to seek the remand at the back of the college on Ojemide Road to enable us to use this space for the expansion of our infrastructure. We are also appealing to the state government to donate directly to our endowment fund. The college is standing between the Dara and Mushi. Both locations have serious security and many problems. Once again, I appeal to the Excellency Babatunde to please help us out by evacuating waste and widening the drainage on the Shaga and Ojemide Road towards the Lasa Maja. This will save us from incessant floods, which regularly render our main gate unsightly and hinders our activities, particularly when it rains. The convergence of cyclists and Okada riders along the college gate also constitute a hindrance to our visitors trying to gain access to the college. We will appreciate if this may be tackled by the state urgently. Lastly, Your Excellency, the college has a block of 6 flats at Chakondi Estate, Kiafa, Solo, which was demolished many years ago due to the fact that the field is integrity safe. We appeal that another block of 6 flats be reallocated to the college to meet the housing needs of our staff members. We would also be grateful if the state government directly allocate state phone lines to our staff members to purchase, to build their own houses. How can I describe the giant demand who the mantle falls on today to deliver the service for that particular person? He's a brother, a friend, a mentor, a benefactor, a loving husband and father, an orator, a highly cerebral gentleman, a past state governor, an immediate first minister of three different federal ministries, and today the Honourable Minister of Works and Housing for the Federal Republic of Nigeria. Is no other than His Excellency Babatunde, Raji, Fashola, SAN. The letter of today is titled Medical Education of Nigeria, the Challenges of Infrastructural Delay.
I doff my hat to the entire members of the total of the
United States. Ably led by Professor Osare Tenalba Taiwo Ibuwe for an excellent job with the realization that this is the first hybrid Felix Oladejo Memorial Lecture. Once again, welcome. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, I invite you all to pay attention to this thought-provoking lecture. I am certain that the Honourable Minister, our guest speaker, will deliver. Thank you for your attention.
At this occasion, and the wives of the
governor of Lagos State, the first lady of Lagos State, the doctor of education will do, able to be accepted by the former permanent secretary, establishment and training in Lagos State. So Mrs. Julia and the speaker, the guest speaker of today, the Honourable Minister of Works for the Federal Republic of Nigeria, our former governor of Lagos State, former action governor of Lagos State. Provost College of Medicine, Professor David Ote, CMD, Professor Bode, the Registrar of the Council of Lagos, Oladejo and Teachers Fire, other principal officers of College of Medicine, Council of Lagos, Deans of Faculties of the College of Medicine, another dean of the University of Lagos here present, and I represented to present. Let me rest on all other protocols that have been established by the Deputy Provost, College of Medicine. But let me take special recognition of Papa Honourable, former Chairman of the Board of Governors of the University of Lagos, former Council Member of the University of Lagos, Papa, that is the top quality we support every time. You are welcome, sir. And also the family of Joseph Kuhn here respected. Thank you very much for giving up your father's legacy. The Vice Chancellor of the University of Lagos, Professor Kuhn, you will be I am here this morning, but she is unable to come because of, as I just said, was supposed to come. But this morning, other actions of the university are taking away. So he has asked me to represent him. He put the serious premium on this lecture, but he doesn't give to fit that it is important for him to be here. Professor Omotola, former Vice Chancellor of the University of Lagos, has said that if we do not recognize ourselves and celebrate ourselves, and our people who are the past leaders of our community, nobody will do it for us. And so we are grateful to the organizers of this event, from the website the College of the University of Lagos, to represent to honor the second provost of College of Medicine and the first emeritus professor of the University of Lagos. It's a great thing to be. I think being the first of so many things made it imperative that it should be celebrated. They are the people that laid the foundation for those good things we are seeing today, that we are running after, that we are delayed foundation and we are building on them. So it is important that this lecture should be continued and people elevated to a higher pedestal. We are happy to have the Honourable Minister speak on the topic medical education in Nigeria, the challenges of infrastructural decay. Being the Honourable Minister of Infrastructure, he knows about it, and especially to put it in the context of the medical, which is very, very important, because if anything happens to any one of us, the most important thing is to have life. Whether you have all the money in the world, you do have life, or you do have good health, everything is secondary, and hope that through his lecture, we shall have positive changes that will make it possible for us to have improvement on the challenges faced by the medical school, most especially the challenges of infrastructure at the University of Lagos.
Medical College youth. We thank the family that produced Professor Dosekun and the legacies being followed by the family. I can see online so many of them, doctors, professors, carrying on the good legacy left by the family. We congratulate you and pray that you continue to put the family life, the family name in good review, so that you can continually remember their progress. Let me reiterate what the provost requested for from the Honourable, our guest of honor today, every respected by Dr. Raji. So I pray that you send our request through the first lady, to the first man and governor of the country, that the youth campus is choked. And one of the best ways to expand is to have that hope nearby us, so that we will be able to have a place. Like, that's what is giving us an iconic building. When there's no space to build it, they may take it elsewhere. So we hope that they will help us look into that, so that the space can be able to have a place to build. And also, that our access to college of medicine. I know if it's federal, if the state government is supported with something, they can do something. On trade, major thing, where the College of Medicine will be introduced. Even if the College of Medicine is very good inside, if the entry will be biased already, that nothing will be in this place. So we will be happy if the Lagos State Government can help us do something about the entry to the college. We know they've done something before, and we appreciate that the point that we do something more. Let us appreciate all members of staff of College of Medicine that are carrying on the good work done by the founding father, Professor Oladejo Dosekun, which we are celebrating today. I have seen the University of Lagos College of Medicine and the sister, Lagos State, Lagos University Teaching Hospital, doing wonderful things despite their small or bigger resources. We have seen wherever we go all over the world, products of this university are doing very, very well. And things that are impossible even in America are made possible here, despite the bigger resources. That shows that it is impossible. That shows that it is possible for us to do more wondrous things. If they are given a little more funding, and then you know that even if funding is coming, the University of Lagos, being the University of First Choice and the Nation's Pride, should be given priority. And I will implore all our alumni, wherever they may be, that they come to the rescue of the College of Medicine, University of Lagos. That said, let me thank all the organizers for doing a good job, and thank our alumni that have presented both here and online, that keep on the good work that is being done, keep on the good work that is made, the foundation made by our founding fathers, and hope that next 2 years we shall congregate again to listen to another wonderful lecture that we presented. I thank you all for coming and God bless.
Thank you, another round of applause to our GDC. Thank you very much, sir. Please, I want to humbly announce that if you are in the hall and you are connected online, please kindly disconnect your connection, because it's affecting those who are online listening to us. If you are here and you are still connected with any device, please try and disconnect so that the interference will not disturb those that are online. It is time to listen to our social guest of honor, Dr. Mrs. Jokerson, who will be represented by Mrs. Roda
advisor, former permanent secretary, Ministry of Trade and Establishment of Labour Peace.
You're welcome. How do I understand your land of law, please? Just keep clapping on the mouth, the podium.
Her Excellency, the First Lady of Lagos State, Dr. Mrs. Claudiana Ijoke-Sanwo-Olu, who is unavoidably absent, and she sends her apology for her absence. She's not been able to make this program because of exigencies of state assignment. I hope her apology is accepted. I read her message to this House. The Honourable Minister of Works and Housing, His Excellency Babatunde Raji Fashola, SAA, who happens to be our big daddy in Lagos State, the Vice Chancellor, University of Lagos, Professor Oladejo Dosekun, ably represented by the DVC Academics and Research, Professor Oladejo, the Registrar, College of Medicine, Mr. Oladejo Dosekun, the Provost, College of Medicine, Professor Adewale, who happens to be our very own in Lagos State too, before coming back here. The Deputy Provost, Professor Osarite Ebwehi, who also happens to be the Chairman of the Organizing Committee, all past provosts and deputy provosts here present and who are online, all principal officers, all faculty deans, all heads of departments here present and online, Honourable former chairman of Court of Governors, I acknowledge you, sir, family members of late Professor.
I happen to be the wife of the grandson of the king, too. I must acknowledge.
Distinguished ladies and gentlemen, students of the college, I recognize you because you are our future. Gentlemen of the press, I go to the address of Her Excellency. It is a great privilege to be part of today's occasion in honor of an accomplished physiologist and medical educator, the late Professor Felix Oladejo Dosekun. The late Professor Dosekun was the first Vice Dean Medical School of this great institution, who lived a life full of achievements and demonstration of leadership. No conversation can be entertained on the birth and growth of this College of Medicine, which happens to be the first in Nigeria without the mention of his name. As the first president of the Physiological Society of Nigeria, Professor Dosekun is known prominently for pursuing advancement in medical education. This is why the title of this year's memorial lecture, Medical Education in Nigeria, the Challenges of Infrastructural Decay, is highly remarkable. In one of late Professor Nini Briggs of the University of Portapa's paper, which he titled, The Making of a Great Medical School, we were made to understand that the attainment of excellence and proficiency is the aim of every university. And to achieve this goal, the environment in which education and training occurs must be advanced. With the ongoing challenges in the healthcare delivery systems, medical education facilities have both a responsibility and an opportunity to ensure students are poised positively to impact on their communities. Therefore, the priority of school management is to create an innovative medical learning community that will give students an engaging learning experience that leads to greater retention and ultimately improved real-world application. In ensuring that today's medical education facilities fit into tomorrow's healthcare system, we must build a university system that enables consistent research with staff that are totally engaged in the pursuit of breaking new grounds and generating knowledge that will contribute to progress in the profession. A university that diligently educates, stimulates, and motivates students to acquire relevant knowledge and skills for a profession or academic career in medicine and to commit to lifelong learning. This is the ambition of the late Professor Dosekun for this university and her students. Ladies and gentlemen, for us as government, we are encouraged by the vision of Professor Dosekun to lead sustainable efforts to meet the needs of today's students for the sake of tomorrow's patients. I want to appreciate the organizers of this event for upholding the culture of excellence and ensuring this series continues to have great impact on present and future generations of medical students. Thank you all for your attention. Dr. Mrs. Ibi Jokerson, First Lady, Lagos State. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mark, for that stimulating message. We appreciate it. I would like to recognize the Dean, Faculty of Pharmacy, Professor Glory Ajayi. You're welcome. Now we want to listen to the favorite song of late Professor F.O. Just a complete.
And his personal academic achievements. Professor Dosekun was an irrepressible and tireless academician who, along with other staff, formed the matrix that ensured that this medical college was established on a very strong foundation in the early 1960s. And I can attest to the fact that that legacy has been upheld, largely due to the fact that he really imparted his students. He was the first university teacher from whom the first students received a lecture on Monday, the first week of September in 1964. So indeed, a man of very first. He, as was his usual pattern, arrived at the classroom promptly at 8 a.m. A bastion of energy, smartly dressed, in his brown bow tie and white short sleeve shirt, over a brown pair of trousers and a black pair of shoes. Well, in those days, it was fashionable to have a cigar or a pipe in your mouth. And in our years in Ife, I think we'd really be a disservice if we did not complete that image with his pipe in his mouth. Professor Dosekun was an awesome person. His charisma was of great repute, and he was a captivating person of eloquence, and he used all this to great advantage. He was so versatile in knowledge and could teach most subjects, and it's little wonder that he obtained his degrees at the Trinity College Dublin in record time, with distinction and first-class honors in several subjects. In recent times, it has become increasingly obvious to the college that our fortunes and the fact that we have come this far since the inception 58 years ago has been as a result of the immense and monumental contribution of our dean of physiology, Professor Dosekun, one of the founding fathers of medical education in Nigeria. Professor Felix Oladejo Dosekun departed mortal life on 27 August 1996. At the right age of 74. It has become a firm tradition of the college to recognize and honor staff that have left an indelible mark in medical education and research, and hence its resolve to honor the first president of the college, the late Felix Oladejo Dosekun, at this memorial lecture. Indeed, the history of CMU cannot be written without acknowledging. So despite the challenges of the present time, we are indeed honored to host the 7th Professor Felix Oladejo Dosekun Memorial Lecture. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you very much for that detailed citation of our late professor. I would call on Professor Honourable to give the citation of the guest lecturer of today.
Her Excellency the Governor, the wife of the Governor of Lagos State, the Vice Chancellor of the University of Lagos State, you represented. I want to acknowledge also the man I'm about to read the citation, the Honourable Minister, and also acknowledge all the leadership of both the College of Medicine and the University of Lagos. Before I read the citation, I must say that I am wearing glasses. I must also say that I am left-handed. I must also say that I have a lot of gray hair. And so that people don't confuse me with the guest lecturer, I shaved off the gray hair to skin cut. On a trip in the United Kingdom, I was on a coach. And when we arrived at our station, the coach driver apologized that we sincerely apologize that we are arriving 5 minutes earlier than scheduled. And we were all looking at ourselves, those who were Nigerians. That when people even arrive 30 minutes after schedule, they don't even apologize. The time of this lecture is supposed to start by 12:20, and it's just 12:10, so I apologize to the Honorable Minister that we'll have his lecture 10 minutes ahead of schedule. The abridged profile of the Honourable Minister of Works and Housing, His Excellency Mr. Babatunde Raji, Fashola, SAN. Born on the 28th of June in 1963 in the city of Lagos, Mr. Babatunde Raji, Fashola, SAN is a 1987 law graduate of the University of Benin. Because we knew he would become a Minister of Works, we allowed him to go to Benin to do his studies so that he could know more about Nigeria. After a 14-year stint in law practice, he had a public service career that is now 18 years long and still running. In that period of public service, he served as Chief of Staff and Commissioner in the Lagos State Government, two-term Governor of Lagos State, and is now serving a second term as the Minister of the Federal Government, having first been appointed in 2015 and reappointed in 2019. In fact, during his first term as the minister, he became a foreman. When one man occupies four ministries, he is a foreman. Babatunde Fashola was called to the Nigerian Bar in November 1988. His career as a barrister started in the law firm of Sokunde Osakwe Ogunigbe and Belgore, where he engaged in general litigation over diverse areas like company law, labor disputes, commercial disputes, criminal law, matrimonial causes, chieftaincy matters, land disputes, administrative law, and intellectual property, to mention a few. We mentioned a few. As an advocate, Mr. Fashola has distinguished himself. In August 2004, he was conferred with the rank of the Senior Advocate of Nigeria, SAN, Nigeria's highest legal distinction. He is the first member of the 1988 law school set to take the rank of Senior Advocate of Nigeria. A round of applause. And also the second graduate of the University of Benin Faculty of Law to be so honored. If the guest speaker were here, he would have been standing in front of us, but I'm sure he's ready. But I want to say that Mr. Babatunde Raji Fashola is a recipient of the prestigious Stephen J. Solas Award of the International Crisis Group in 2015, and for his commitment to building a peaceful and vibrant society, his work to improve social and economic conditions in Lagos State, including his role in preventing the Ebola outbreak from becoming a crisis. As a public servant, he has served with no less distinction and dedication, and has been acknowledged locally and internationally for his dedication to service. In 2004, he was listed as one of the top 100 top global thinkers for 2013 by the Global Personality Assessment Organization, Luz Pasiogela Politica, LSDP. No wonder the organization is LSDP. It sounds like Lagos State Development and Public Works. This organization is based in Italy and in Brussels. The Time magazine has commended him for the overhaul of the Lagos infrastructure, while the Economist magazine acknowledged him as a rare good man and a governor who does his job well. Of course, we all know that his mantra, he who works hard gets more work. Mr. Fashola, SAN, is a patron, Chartered Institute of Arbitrators, member Nigerian Bar Association, member International Bar Association, fellow of the Chartered Institute of Taxation of Nigeria. Yes, he has to be in taxation. The Notary Public of the Supreme Court of Nigeria. Distinguished ladies and gentlemen, it is my pleasure to present, to deliver his lecture titled Medical Education in Nigeria, the Challenges of Infrastructural Decay, Mr. Babatunde Raji Fashola, SAN. Married to Dame Emmanuel Adebola Fashola, and blessed with children. So, my pleasure, Honourable Minister,
for listening to your lecture. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And good afternoon. Let me thank the Provost, the Deputy Provost, and the members of the Organizing Committee of this memorial lecture. Let me acknowledge the presence of the representative of the First Lady of Lagos State, Dr. Ibijoke Sanwo-Olu, who is also a professional in this field that is hosting me in the field of medicine. Let me especially acknowledge members of the Dosekun family, some of whom I can see online, and all of the members of the College of Medicine who hold aloft the torch of the dream of the founding fathers of the school. I had to make some difficult choices today, whether to speak at this event or whether to be with the Institute of Strategic Studies in Jos to speak on a related matter. And I think that what tilted this, and I'm happy that I'm here, is that it was the first commitment I made many months ago to speak here. And I thank you for inviting me. Distinguished ladies and gentlemen, let me again say how delighted I am to be the guest lecturer at this seventh edition, I'm told, of the Dosekun Memorial Lecture. And the letter inviting me contains very, very illuminating information about the far-sighted vision behind the founding of this College of Medicine way back in 1961, especially the desire of the founders to prevent death from lack of medical care. I will therefore not make any further comment about that matter. And I was also informed that when it was formally dedicated on the third day of October and opened its doors to many practitioners, including Professor Emeritus Felix Oladejo Dosekun, now of blessed memory, whose scholarship, intellect, and dedication we gather to celebrate today. A lot has been said about his dedication to the development of the next generation of medical practitioners. And again, I will speak less about him. That today. It is about us that I will speak, because we are the torchbearers, we are the inheritors of the legacy of the founders. And many who are in this gathering today are possibly products of those Professor Dosekun's training. So in that regard, my first concern was, I wish I could change my topic. I wish that the topic assigned me was different. And the topic assigned me was, quote, medical education in Nigeria and challenges of infrastructural decay. Regrettably, the invitation letter did not offer that luxury. And the reason I would have been inclined to change it is very simple. It is because infrastructure does and truly decay. It does. This is a reality that we must come to terms with. Therefore, it is, in my view, not a challenge. Rather, it is the essence of our existence. Everything that man makes diminishes or depreciates or withers. Therefore, a different approach, in my view, would be that we should be in a conversation about how to prevent or to slow down the decay or the depreciation. And related to that, how to replace or renew the infrastructure when it reaches the end of useful life. Yes, when it reaches the end of useful life, because infrastructure has life limits. Whether it is a building, whether it is a road, whether it is a bridge, an airport, a seaport, and indeed a hospital, or even a university, at least the buildings in it, the idea of a universal exchange of ideas perhaps will outlive the infrastructure that makes it that environment. Because things progress to a point where even though the asset exists as a matter of fact, whether it's a bridge, a road, whatever it is, a theater, a ward, emergency room, whatever it is, a classroom, an auditorium, even though it exists as a matter of fact, it may no longer be able to deliver on its intended purpose. It may no longer be able to deliver on its intended purpose, either because its capacity has been exceeded, as is perhaps now the case in this college, I don't know that, or the cost of keeping it going is no longer economical, or that the parts necessary to operate it are no longer being produced in sufficient quantity because the model may have changed, as is the case with equipment like diagnostic. And let us just look at a few things. I think that many who are my age will remember the 1-2-3 model of the Mercedes-Benz and made in the 70s. They are now vintage. If you have one, it is something that you keep more as an antique. You may have to import parts. You may have to ship the vehicle to specialize teams of mechanics, and so on and so forth. So that is infrastructure aging. That is infrastructure probably reaching the end of useful life. I will share with you one of my own personal experiences when I was governor. We inherited an asphalt plant built by Aladija Konde in the 70s, late 70s and early 80s. At the time I took office, that plant was operating at perhaps 20 to 30% capacity. We tried to get the original manufacturers to fix it, and they said, look, we'll stop producing the parts. But we were lucky, we were determined. We found the engineers who worked in that manufacturing plant when it was producing our own model. And they took it on as a private arrangement and refabricated.
He is a student of the College of Medicine, University of Lagos.
I can hear you, sir.
Okay, so I think that I stopped at the point where I was emphasizing how infrastructure depreciates. And if there is one infrastructure we all need to get in sufficient quantity, it is broadband connectivity in an efficient and reliable way, as we have just seen whilst I was speaking. But that is part of the journey that we have begun. So the conversation I would have loved to have, therefore, and is one about how to replace, how to expand, how to renew, rather than being challenged by what will happen. And I will set the context by referring to the Lagos University Teaching Hospital, the Diaraba Loop, which was and still is the theater of expression. That's what I call it, the theater of expression for teachers and practitioners of medicine in the College of Medicine in the University of Lagos. My mother once worked in that hospital as a nurse. And I remember the days when we sometimes accompanied her to work, either during a holiday period, when there was no help to leave us with, or when I also needed a doctor. And as a child, I needed doctors quite often. And I still tell people about the creche or the children's room in Louth. It looked like something out of a movie. I can almost still smell the chocolate drink, the sandwiches and biscuits that we, the children, were served while our parents worked. I also recall that sometime around 10 to 11 a.m., there was something like a tea or coffee break right across the hospital, where nurses, doctors, and other practitioners gathered in different tea rooms across Louth to refresh and recharge before going back to administer life-saving care to their patients. To the credit of the founders and the practitioners who ran this facility, people like Professor Dosekun, their vision was being fulfilled. Many were saved from death that could have arisen from lack of adequate medical care. So the question should be whether that same hospital is still there or whether a better one has sprung up in its place. And if not, where did that hospital go? And what can we or should we do to recreate or restore that hospital? Because as I said, it was the theater of expression where the dreams of the College of Medicine became fully manifest, where lives were being saved. Therefore, in pivoting back to my topic, I contend that instead of being challenged by infrastructural decay, we should ask ourselves, what quality of infrastructure does Nigeria's medical education now require? And in what quantity? I repeat that question. What is the quality of infrastructure that Nigeria's medical education now require? And in what quantity? These are questions, in my view, which require an understanding, first, of the number of medical practitioners that our country needs, in what areas. And it is from the number that we need that we can begin to project and design the kind of infrastructure that will support them. Not only classrooms, but hostel and training facilities. We also need to ask about the quality and the type of the medical practitioners that we now need. Do we need medical practitioners of the type that were needed in 1961 when the school was conceived? Or as our world changed in a way that we perhaps need medical practitioners of a different hue, different type, different capacity, and different specialty. I think until we answer those questions, it might be premature to begin to say this is what we need in terms of infrastructure. And so I ask rhetorically, do we want medical practitioners who treat, or do we want those who provide care, or do we want both? Because that will inform the kind of education that we give them, and it may serve to inform the type of infrastructure and the environment in which we produce them. Because the input will be, it is clear without a doubt that there is one infrastructure that we truly need. And I think that even the College of Medicine will benefit from that infrastructure, because this is the first time that I am losing connectivity through a Zoom conference in over a year. But, so I was at the point where I was talking about the kind of practitioners we now need as a way of designing the infrastructure that would help to deliver them. And I wanted to make the point, and I will now, that in today's increasing specialties, we must ask ourselves whether we need more medical education about public health, and whether we need our personnel, practitioners, to focus on prevention rather than curative medicine. We must ask ourselves, those who are close to Professor Dosekun in his lifetime, what we would think he would be doing now if he were with us. What path would he be charting in this regard? Would he be focusing on preventive health or curative health? And in this regard, we should be asking ourselves what the existing data about prevalence in terms of afflictions that our people suffer from show, and in what parts of the country are these data coming from? Because this is the basis for development of methods and programs. And we must also ask ourselves now, are we going to continue, or are we still teaching medicine the way it was taught in 1964 on a general and across the board basis for our country to diversify and create specialties in different parts of our country where data shows prevalence of certain types of affliction? And let me just illuminate that. I know that there used to be a foremost college of a foremost center for eye surgery in Kaduna, the Mando Eye Center. I don't know what its current condition is. I know that somewhere along Lagos Benin Expressway, before you get to Benin, there's a leper colony there. What are we doing to eradicate leprosy? And perhaps is there a specialty or a center there where experts in matters relating to viruses, such as leprosy virus, can be trained? But these are the things that will determine what we build, what we buy, what we develop, and what we create. It depends on how we want to go. And so it is some of these types of questions that I have sought to pose, and the answers to them that will provide illuminating information as to the type of infrastructure that will be required to deliver the medical education that we need for today and for tomorrow. These are the types of questions that I believe that the founders of this college most likely asked themselves in the period between 1961, when the journey of this college began, and 1963, when it was formally inaugurated. Therefore, ladies and gentlemen, instead of being challenged by the problems of the day, those founders were motivated to act. This points the fingers directly at you and I to act without further delay. This is why I said earlier that I would speak less about the founders and less about Professor Dosekun and much more about us as torchbearers, because the obligation is now ours. The responsibility falls upon us to act. The responsibility that you all have as practitioners is to undertake this inquiry and bring forth the needs that those inquiries dictate. Our responsibility as government, and I say this because the school is a government-owned school, so our responsibility as a government is to query those needs, embrace them as we verify them, and then develop the designs, the budget, and to raise the funding to provide them. But truly, the work does not end with providing the infrastructure. It only begins there. As I have sought to explain earlier, infrastructure will age, it will become outgrown, it will become outdated, and it will become inefficient. The real work lies in the maintenance and the repair and the rehabilitation of infrastructure. And so this takes me to a larger national picture, and which is the picture of the replacement, renewal, and regeneration of infrastructure that is going on in our country now, whether it is the expansion of our airports or the building of new seaports, or indeed the building of new roads and bridges and the maintenance. So in 2019, our administration approved a national infrastructure maintenance program arising from a policy that I had the privilege to present to the Federal Executive Council. The result of that maintenance program was that it saw to the emergence of a Department of Federal Public Asset Maintenance, with the first one established in the Ministry of Works and Housing. The full implementation of the policy is expected to see every ministry, department, and agency of the federal government create its own department for maintenance, budget for it, and undertake the procurement of its periodic maintenance of infrastructure utilized or managed by each ministry, department, or agency. As I said at the beginning of my intervention today, I should also have been at NIPS, and this is the same subject at NIPS: infrastructure maintenance and the implications for our national economy. So while the development of this policy is being undertaken, the Ministry of Works is already intervening in the road network of federal tertiary institutions, and a total of 44 of them are either being built, rebuilt, benefiting from rebuilding of their road network, repairing of the existing route, or the rehabilitation of their existing road network. And one of the beneficiaries, I must say, is the University College Hospital Ibadan. I know that the University of Lagos has also applied, and we're looking at what we can do, because our resources are limited, and we're looking at what we can do in that school this year. But we are in 44 federal tertiary institutions. And as I said, this involves either construction, reconstruction, or rehabilitation as the need has arisen in each of the schools. The Ministry of Works is also rehabilitating 25 existing federal secretariats across Nigeria to restore them to their construction status or something close to that. And we have also issued facility management contracts for maintenance to contractors to keep them in post-rehabilitation condition and operation. The ministry is also undertaking maintenance works on 37 bridges across Nigeria, which includes underwater repairs, welding of reinforcement, replacement of vandalized or stolen rails, pavement resurfacing, and replacement of damaged bearings and expansion joints. For those of you who live in Lagos, we all had to endure the closure related to the rehabilitation of the Third Mainland Bridge. The work is not finished. We have only finished the work on the deck, which you can see, and on the bearings, which you can see. But the next phase of the work is now work being done underwater, which many of you will not see. But I have asked that this screen be shared. And if we go back to the first slide, now, just to show you, to make the point as graphically and illustratively as it could, that is why I asked that these slides be put up. And if we go back to the first slide, if the manager of the screen sharing function can do that, you will just see, can you go back to the first slide? Yes. No, this is the eighth slide. Yes. So let's just take one at a time very quickly. So if you go to the next one now. I hope you can see what is being shared. Now, can you go to the next slide? Okay. Yes, this is, charity must begin at home. So this is the headquarters of the Ministry of Works and Housing. The top photograph shows what it looks like when I resumed here. And if you go through the next slides, the cladding work that we have done. So our conference room used to look like what is at the top. This is now what it looks like, the photographs at the bottom. And if you go on and on, if you go to the next one, the next slide, 4. Yes, please. Yes. Now, it's instructive. To the left at the top is what the main conference room of the ministry looked like. But after rehabilitation, the photographs at the bottom show you what they now look like. To the right, at the top is what the Federal Secretariat in Kaduna used to look like. After rehabilitation is a photograph at the bottom of the page. And this is what you will see in all the other slides. Internal and external rehabilitation and restoration in some cases, repairs in others, and this has been now followed by the provision of maintenance, facility maintenance contractors who now clean every day, which was not there before. And this is what I recommend for addressing the challenges, as you say, but I see more the proactiveness about preparation for infrastructure because usage will generate wear and tear. So what this speaks to, and I will continue, we can send these slides later to the school should you wish to pursue the matter further. What this speaks to is first the creation of jobs for artisans, and it reinforces my own long-held view that maintenance is not a culture. People say, oh, we don't have maintenance culture. Maintenance is not a culture. Which was nourished as an enterprise to employ people and also to preserve the life cycle of the infrastructure. Therefore, whilst we undertake the survey of what is needed to develop medical education of our dreams as a short to medium term objective, the undertaking of now, the undertaking of now, today, is the immediate rehabilitation and restoration of the assets of the College of Medicine, University of Lagos, and of its Theater of Expression, the University Teaching Hospital, and the immediate inauguration of a maintenance plan. Now, let me again share my experience with some of you who are more experienced than I am. In the last decade or more, thereabouts, we have seen instances of people, our helpers, those who love us, in quote, coming into Nigeria or offering us, oh, one hospital is donating equipment, one hospital is donating beds, one hospital is, and we go almost cap in hand to go and receive those things. But when you, but what we don't see is why those donations are being made. What is happening is that they are replacing, they are rehabilitating, they are expanding, they are investing. I witnessed one firsthand in Cook County Hospital in Chicago, where they were giving out equipment. And that was the day I decided as governor that our state will not accept secondhand or used equipment, and that we would rather buy brand new ones. We will develop, we will expand, and you will see the program that we started to reposition Lasuth, to rebuild Aike House, and some of the other facilities. It's a long journey. Oftentimes, those who start it may not finish it. In some unfortunate cases, you may not even see it. But it's a journey that we must start. So beyond the hardware of hospital infrastructure, like buildings, equipment, and personnel, and their contribution to healthcare, there is a very, very important matter of human behavior, which I call the infrastructure of the mind. No matter the quality of infrastructure that we build, if the people don't use it properly, it will not serve the purpose. So we see roads where trucks are overloaded, axle load regulations are exceeded. Again, that's behavior that has to be corrected. We see roads newly built where speed limits of 100 kilometers as maximum is prescribed, and people are running and speeding at 140, 150 kilometers. That is where infrastructure of the mind must take place. That is abuse, not proper use. And all of these things must be changed. It has applicability, in my view, to healthcare, because I believe that well-being and wellness lies in our collective attitude to sanitation. Very too often, our conversations about the status of our health systems seems to have focused more predominantly on the quality of our health facilities rather than on the quality of our environment. We seem to have focused more on the number of hospitals and doctors. Whilst that is good, and nurses, whilst that is good, I think that the more ought to be on the quality of the environment. My firmly held view is that our bodies were designed to be functional rather than to be in a health facility like a hospital. I think our bodies, if a parallel can be drawn, It's not different from vehicles. Cars are made to run rather than to be in a mechanic garage. Therefore, just as we cannot build enough garages if all cars were to break down, we cannot build enough hospital spaces if we all fall ill. The COVID-19 virus has shown that even societies with an abundance of hospital facilities soon became overwhelmed until they returned to the basics. Basics such as hand washing, social distancing, and in extreme cases, lockdowns. The point I seek to make, therefore, is that sanitation, more than therapy and treatment, has been the biggest bequest of medicine and science to our civilization. The ideal healthcare system must therefore emphasize more on proper refuse disposal, appropriate provision and use of water, eradication of unsanitary behavior like open defecation and urination, and focus on proper nutrition and lifestyle. If that is the ideal healthcare system, it is my considered view that the practitioners who will deliver that ideal medical system must be within our peripheral vision as we envision the kind of infrastructure that we will require to birth them. Therefore, the design and the development of that healthcare system must be seen in the context of a battle between wellness and illness. If we see this context, then the healthcare system of choice that will inform the medical education of need must be one that ensures that wellness often, if not always, triumphs over illness. By extension, we must then build and develop a medical education that enthrones wellness over illness. This is as basic as I think I would like to put it. And if that is the hub of the medical system that we want, then we can begin to design the medical education that will deliver it. If we design the medical education, then it is easy to envision the infrastructure that will make this possible. So these are my thoughts about the direction in which medical education should be heading in Nigeria, especially the need to focus on public health as a growing field of specialty, epidemiology, for example, and virology, as there will be new viruses and epidemics. That is a given. We must prepare to deal with them. We have seen MERS, SARS, and so on, and we are dealing with COVID, and it is mutating, and there will be more. So we are extremely dependent for vaccines. So our medical education must begin to prepare us to be more sufficient, reliant on our own capacities. In addition, nutrition, sports, and specialties must come within the focus and training manuals in our medical schools. As we have seen today, we have been disconnected twice, and I hope we won't be disconnected again before I finish. ICT competence and proficiency, along with biomedical engineering, must be focal areas of our medical education, and we must acquire the infrastructure to train students in this area. Of course, we could never have too much capacity or specialty in trauma management and emergency medicine, more so in a world now prone to more disasters. Indeed, as the alarm bells ring about climate change and damage to our ecology and our environment, I believe it is eminent common sense for schools of medicine to begin to simulate what it might be like when nature fights back. What kind of injuries and trauma do we expect to see when nature begins to fight back? Because nature will fight back. What kind of practitioners do we expect to be in position to treat those injuries? And I think that if we ask these questions, we can and we will be able to design the medical infrastructure that is necessary to deal with that. Extreme winds, extreme sunlight, extreme harmattan, and extreme flooding, what can they do to our bodies? Are we prepared? These are some of the thoughts that will hopefully beam a bright light on the type of infrastructure that will be needed in today and in tomorrow's medical schools to deliver the kind of education that responds to tomorrow's needs. Of course, any of these count for very little without the right values and ethics, which are the moral compasses for the practice of medicine. When all is finally said and done, the best schools are built, the best professors like Professor Dosekun teach, at the end of the day, what are the ethical values and the moral controls for the practitioners we build? This is an even more important consideration at a time when science is pushing the frontiers and breaking boundaries of what we know. The medical practitioners of today and tomorrow must be raised and nurtured with the finest of ethics and the very best of values. Those who we train to exercise godlike powers on us must rise to the exalted realm of their powers. And let me make this point. I once told some medical doctors that nobody can tell me to take off my clothes. Only doctors do that, and I obey. They're almost like God, medical practitioners who want to examine you, who want to administer treatment. It's almost God-like powers. And so those who exercise those powers must have the very, very highest of values. They must be guided by the most admirable of ethics. Because I say this in the context of the strikes that go on in hospitals and so on. And I don't disregard the need for welfare, but I make the point very strongly. So medicine, in my view, is not a job. It is a calling. A calling by those who are guided by the very, very finest of values and trained in the highest of ethics. So as they say, if gold rusts, what should iron do? Thank you for listening.
We want to really appreciate you, sir, for the wonderful, very, very clear lecture this very afternoon. We really appreciate you for your time. We are very grateful for the honor you bestowed on us to grace the occasion of today. And I believe we have all our leaders here, and all that you have said is well noted and taken.
an action will definitely follow. Once again, you are very, very grateful, sir. Thank you very much.
Distinguished ladies and gentlemen, no doubt we have all listened to a well-delivered, thought-provoking lecture delivered by the guest speaker of the seventh memorial lecture of Felix Oladejo Dosekun at the College of Medicine, University of Lagos, in the person of His Excellency Babatunde, Raji, Fashola, SAN, Honourable Minister of Works and Housing. Based on your scholarly presentation and delivery of the lecture today, we would like to present an appreciation award to the Honourable Minister, Babatunde, Raji, Fashola, SAN, on the topic Medical Education in Nigeria, the Challenges of Infrastructure and Digital. At the 7th Felix Oladejo Dosekun Memorial Lecture, which took place at the College of Medicine, University of Lagos on Thursday, April 8, 2021. On behalf of the Provost of the College of Medicine, Professor Adewale David and Tony Oke, I'd like to present this award to our Honorable Minister, Babatunde Raji Fashola, SAN, for giving us the best of all lectures in the FOD Memorial Lecture. Thank you very much.
On behalf of the Honourable Minister, thank you very, very much. I wish you all the best. Thank you very much, Honourable Minister. Before we conclude the award, I want to just kindly permit me possibly to please make an important recognition. We have with us this afternoon the chairman of Sulawesi Local Government, Honourable Tabidin Ajie, and he has supported this lecture very generously. Thank you very much, sir. We appreciate you, and we appreciate all that you've been doing for the college. Thank you, sir. Now we will call on the First Lady of Lagos State, ably represented by our former Cabinet Secretary, to come to receive her award. So come on, the Deputy Provost and the
Senate. Well, the University of Lagos, First College of Medicine, representing you, Dr. Mr. Lucas, who is the for your contribution to medical education in Nigeria, and for your presence at the memorial.
Same day,
we are making a presentation to the Lagos State Government, for all he has done in the past. We know that all he will continue to do for us in Lagos State.
On behalf of His Excellency, the Governor of Lagos State, Mr. Babatunde Fashola, and Her Excellency Dr. Mrs. Claudiana Ijokeolu Sowolu, I say very big thank you to the College of Medicine and the University of Lagos as a whole. God bless you.
Good afternoon.
our special guests, ladies and gentlemen, medical students, and all we have working staff in the College of Medicine. On behalf of the Dosekun family, we would like to thank you all for still remembering Prof. Doe. Prof. Doe was an enigma, an individual born years before his time. And he was so passionate about quality, he was passionate about ethics, he was passionate by being led by a high level of our moral compass. And I am an in-law, as married to his second son, and I learned a lot. Getting married to the Dosekun family. It's a family full of doctors, but not doctors only in title, but doctors who are very committed and passionate about what they address or what they are doing. I would like to give a little story about when I was in medical school in my fourth year and why they had collaborated. Our training was so thorough. Very, very high level of not only training, behavior, decorum, ethics, etc., etc. There was a lecturer that came from Manchester, professor of pediatrics, and was my examiner during the part one exam. And after he examined me, and it was my long case, when the lecturers now convened, he said it is impossible that that doctor hadn't seen that patient before. He said, you cannot be so confident and so thorough. And they went to call the mother and said, have you met this doctor? I was this for sure all that time. And he said, no. She said, I've never seen her before. He said, have you ever come to the clinic in Loop before? He said, no. My clinic is in Kenya General Hospital. They just came that morning to pick me up. I have never seen her before. It was from the late Professor Wunipe. He said, they all felt like they're coming out, carrying me, and running around the compound of the hospital. So that was the question. And of course, I got the best prize. They gave me the charity prize to the end. That was the quality of education we had. One that a professor of pediatrics from Manchester said, it is impossible. This young lady has cheated. She did something wrong. So it's our founding fathers that set this up for us. So I am so glad, and I'm glad there's an endowment fund. And I know my boss in America and you, I can see them there as Professor Dosekun and Dr. Whitney are going to do us proud. I will also try my own little way. I thank you very much for this recognition to the family.
Thank you very much for that speech. I'd like to recognize some of our online viewers. We have Dr. Raji, who helped us to be an alumnus of this great institution, MBBS 1974. Also, our very own professor, Professor Oladejo Dosekun, aka Nebraska, Max Center, alumnus 1974. We are proud of you, very much with us online. Dr. Francis Olutu, also alumnus of this institution. Graduate of 1979. I want to quickly recognize all our role of those who donated generously to the success of this great event. We have Lagoon Hospital's Hygia. Let's give them a round of applause. Also, KPMK donated generously, Red Wire Consulting, also Professor Lada Kwashin, OFR, Max Center. Also, the family, family of the servant of the day, late Felix Oladejo Dosekun family, Dr. Efumbo Dosekun, Nene Dental Clinic, Reddington Multispecialist Hospital, Beacon Hills Smile Group,
Sela, Kamala Special, Specialist Hospital. All these been donated generously. Also, we have Postman Oil Limited. They also did us proud by donating generously towards the success of this.
We want to recognize our mama. She is the former head of department of surgery and the very first female head of department of surgery, and also the past president of the National Postgraduate Medical College of Nigeria. She is a knight of John Wesley in the Methodist Church. Please, once again, we recognize Dame Professor Fashola. Thank you very much for honoring our secretary. Thank you. Congratulations. Thank you.
I'd like to call on our Deputy Vice Chancellor, representing the Vice Chancellor of Adair University, as the Chairman, to give the Chairman's closing remark. Before we have the closing remark of the Chairman, I want to call on the members of the family of late Professor Fashola Dosekun to give one of the goodwill measures. They are online, you can have them now.
Your Excellencies, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, my brother and I prepared a text which we have asked my niece, Dr. Olamide Folashade Dosekun, to read out. It is my pleasure to introduce Dr. Olamide Folashade Dosekun, MBBS MRCP, who is Akison's first daughter and Professor Dosekun's first grandchild. It is a happy coincidence that today is also her birthday. After her basic schooling in Nigeria, she continued her education in the United Kingdom, where she studied medicine at King's College London. She graduated with distinction in 2003. She is an infectious diseases specialist and a consultant in genitourinary and HIV medicine at St. Mary's Hospital, Paddington, London. Since the year 2006, Lamide has authored or co-authored numerous peer-reviewed papers in the area of HIV medicine. Lamide, I hand over to you.
Your Excellency, thank you, Uncle. Your Excellency, the Governor of Lagos State, Mr. Babajide Sanwo-Olu, Your Excellency and Guest of Honour, Honourable Minister of Works and Housing, Mr. Babatunde Raji Fashola, SAN, the Pro-Chancellor of the University of Lagos, the Vice-Chancellor of the University of Lagos, Professor Oluwatoyin Ogundipe, the Chairman of the Organizing Committee of this event in honour of my grandfather, all the academic and non-academic staff of the University of Lagos here present, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, all other protocols duly observed. I've been mandated by the family to present these words, as it were, a tribute to Grandpa Emeritus Professor Felix Oladejo Dosekun. Felix Oladejo Dosekun, FOD, shepherded the school with vision and a steady hand during a tenure that was transformational. In addition to leading and supervising the school's outstanding physical development, he ensured the continuous and innovative evolution of the many curriculums. As a result of his vision, the school, which started with schools of medicine and dental surgery, psychiatry, community health, subsequently added physiotherapy, radiotherapy, radiography, pharmacy, and medical laboratory sciences to its portfolio. He enhanced the mission of the school with ever-increasing bachelor and master's degree programs in anatomy, biochemistry, physiology, pharmacology, pathology, including clinical biochemistry, and medical laboratory sciences. He was determined to establish for the young medical school a tradition of the primacy of basic medical sciences as the bedrock of clinical medical practice. And he was instrumental in the training, encouragement, and development of talented medical students into outstanding medical scientists in these basic sciences through college scholarships in highly reputed schools in the USA and UK. Several beneficiaries of this faculty development program went on to become outstanding teachers, faculty, and university leaders all over the country. Very early, he strongly advocated the importance of computer science, the mathematical sciences in medicine, and of biomedical engineering. In developing the foundations of the college, he reached out to extensive international connections in the medical field and co-opted their support to enable the realization of his vision. His contacts spanned Europe and the Americas in particular, especially Trinity College Dublin, Oxbridge and London University, and a number of centers of excellence in the USA. An old friend of his from student days, a professor of physiology in Rochester, New York, played a large role in getting the new medical school off and running. I well remember that for invigilation sometime in the 70s, an old friend of his and a distinguished physiologist from the West Indies, Emeritus Professor Emmanuel Cyprian Amoroso, was the guest. Likewise, a few years later, I believe it was 1976 or 77, another distinguished professor, a Nobel Prize laureate, I believe, of Swiss or German descent working at the time in Australia, was his guest. Examiners who were invited for the nascent bachelor's degree programs, often with only one single candidate only, were very distinguished teachers and authors of the best textbooks worldwide in their fields. He spent his sabbatical year, which he chose to take only at the end of his career, in the laboratory of his friend at the Sorbonne in Paris, a Nobel laureate. I cite these examples because the problem of medical education in Nigeria goes beyond mere infrastructural decay. All good things require first and foremost an appreciation of their value as an essential good. Second, investments to establish them, and finally, continuing appropriate levels of investment to maintain them and ensure they can continue to deliver what they were set up for. This investment is not only in monetary terms, but also should involve outreach based on each participant's own personal journey, in which he or she makes contacts and friendships, which can be a potent reservoir of values and goodwill, which can then be tapped into in furtherance of the mission of the institution. This is not happening today in the manner and degree to which it was in the 1960s and 70s in Lagos and Ibadan in particular. And especially with respect to investment in higher education in Nigeria and in particular in the medical field. In Nigeria, we have failed woefully in this regard, both at the governance level and as a society. The problem is not with government alone, but also with Nigerian society at large, especially its elite. This is, in our view, the verdict that FOD would arrive at. How much wastage and how little investment by the people in its healthcare institutions, in learning, excellence, and discovery, both at governmental and societal levels. As a people, we have preferred the wrong values. FOD was a pioneer and a giant in medical education, not only in Nigeria, but across most of Africa and beyond. He was well versed in ethics, classics, philosophy, history, culture, and the law, and was a consummate administrator. He was keenly interested in architecture and landscaping, and he was indeed a linguist. Most importantly, he was a totally detribalized Nigerian. Several of his students from all corners of the nation were essentially his adopted children. He was famously and fondly nicknamed Prof. Doe. He was, however, most fervent in his teaching, in preparing and delivering his lectures and demonstrations in the laboratory. When invited to help in the first military government of the old Western Nigeria, he gave one condition alone, that there would be no interference or interruption with his schedule of lectures at the college. Upon retirement to Ondum, he promptly accepted and resumed his life's work of teaching at the University of Ife, driving there to teach and develop minds in the medical field twice a week. Today, he would be advancing the work of the medical schools in our country in such areas as extension of their reach through satellite campuses, partnerships with the Nigerian private sector and local communities, because the mission cannot be that of government alone, as well as the best international institutions. He would be keenly interested in healthcare informatics, healthcare administration and systems, hospital management, genomics, advancing the boundaries of discovery and the new emphasis on wellness, and most importantly, how to develop a cost-effective system of basic healthcare delivery commensurate with our overall living standards to the masses of our people on the basis of the maxim, prevention is better than cure. This was one of the questions he was occupied with towards the end of his life on earth. He was indeed the transformational father of our college, CMUL. Thank you.
Are deans of the faculties in the College of Medicine here present, the college secretary, Dr. Mafabi Moses, our other directors, the Director of Engineering Services, Engineer Oluidi, the Director of Finance, Dr. Akiande, our distinguished professors here present, distinguished invitees, our real fathers of the day, I would like to again thank His Royal Highness over Dr. James Adeyemi, who came all the way from Ondo since yesterday, to honor our invitation, having been a student of our late professor. He is the Afokwe Valley of Ilu Okwe, Ondo. Our past provost and past deputy provost, also present or viewing online, I also want to acknowledge Professor Shofala, who has been online during this event. I also want to acknowledge my teacher, Professor Abelu. Professor Alban Kedishri, and also a former deputy provost of the College of Medicine and our husband. I also want to acknowledge some of our professors who are online viewing all these lectures I will be having. Professor Adeyemi, clinical sciences, Professor Adeyemi again, basic medical sciences, Professor Apolabi, Professor Jaja, Professor Shikogun, Professor Koruma, and Professor Jane Ajinochukwu, and others who are also being linked online. I want to really thank our provost again for giving us the maximum support to organize this memorial lecture within the space of barely 1 month. This is the same memorial lecture that we organized in college. By tradition, takes between 6 months to 1 year. But we are able to carry out this assignment under our watch. I want to thank all the members of the Felix Oladejo Dosekun Memorial Lecture Organizing Team for a job well done. I want to also thank the various subcommittees I created for this purpose, who also did an outstanding contribution to the success of this memorial lecture. Subcommittees such as the fundraising committee, entertainment committee, security, engineering, publicity and logistics, and as well as the strategic and other committees that were set up. I also want to please thank the chairman of one of our neighboring local governments here. In fact, they are actually like our host. So I really must appreciate my chairman, Sule Local Government, for supporting this lecture with a huge donation and for also coming physically to witness this ceremony. Thank you very much, sir. We will also pay you a return visit in the secretariat to appreciate you. I want to especially thank the family of the Felix Oladejo Dosekun for their outstanding support and contribution towards the success of this memorial lecture. I was actually in touch with virtually all the family members who really made huge donations to college and with the promise to do more. Thank you and God bless you. I want to thank all the principal officers of college for their different roles they play for this success of this memorial lecture. And I also like to thank our staff and students who in the different ways also contributed. Let me just run through this as I close. Special thanks and appreciation goes to the following donors: Workman Spirit, Petroman Oil Limited, who actually gave us the highest donation so far, Havana Specialist Hospital, Reddington Multi Specialist Hospital, Friends of the College and our distinguished alumni, the Lagoon Hospital, Dr. Olujini Koka, Red Wire Marketing, Professor Ladako Ashiru OFR, Nene Dental Clinic Limited, Bacon E. Smith Osmai Group, Medical Art Center, Sinla, Medical Convert, and the last but not the least again, the chairman of the Sumer local government, Mr. Fajudin Ajde. So once again, on behalf of the Provost, College of Medicine, Professor Adewale David, hey, Antonio, okay. I'd like to say thank you for giving us this opportunity to organize this seventh Felix Oladejo Memorial Lecture. And I also want to thank our distinguished lecturer who accepted to be the speaker for this year's lecture and who gave us a thought-provoking, brilliant, and scholarly lecture. Once again, thank you for coming and I wish you stay
tuned
to your
middle
destination. God bless you
all. Please kindly be patient with us. Just a little technical hitch. Once again, also I want to particularly thank Professor Akashibo, who joined online, and also the representative of the wife of the governor of Lagos, who helped us to keep the wishes down when we were having downtime of our intervention. Thank you for your divine intervention. So on that note, we'll be right back.
this program to have a reception now. Please, your standing issue, please.
For this program, I want to thank Dr. Clement Oluwarotimi, Dr. Donna Umezi, and my humble self, Ademola Arimo. So thank you until another year, 2 years, of before we have another Felix Dosekun lecture. Have a lovely time. God bless you all. Bye.
Some of his virtues. Do you want to go over those virtues?
Well, I mentioned them. Do you think I knew him like his brother, his friend, his young partner. He's highly cerebral than what he has. Okay? And this is what I expected, that he would give us a lecture that would make us think of this assembly. Instead of facing challenges, we should plan how we can maintain infrastructure, plan it in such a way that it will take things by big scale, diseases, pattern. This is pattern of 1960s, not what we have. Now we have infectious disease, and that's why he highlighted the essence of community medicine, because it's the natural challenges that we face. Tornado, floods, things that we begin to think towards constructing medical equipment in that light. Of course, not forgetting we still have trauma, we still have infection, we still have cancer, and things like that. But there's a changing pattern in this pattern all over the world. And we need to plan education towards certain things.
The emeritus professor was noted as saying that before you can succeed in any field, you must learn the language.
Yeah, he said that to me. He said that to my class. He said, if you don't understand the language of the system, how can you understand how to manage it? That's one of the things. You must learn the language, you must know the language of the system, the language itself.
So if you were to be around, what new changes, what new things do you think would have brought on board?
If he was around, he has brought up a lot right now. Biomedical engineering, for example, is one of the best projects. Now we'll be thinking of vaccine manufacturing is local. We don't have to wait to import the vaccines produced by Pfizer and the others. I'm sure if it was around, I would probably be manufacturing vaccine and exporting to the world.
So living within his legacy, do you think, or you saying that we should be hoping or expecting the production of local vaccine?
It's already on. There's a rumor that Dharma is a Nigerian vaccine. It's already on. I've heard in the news that very soon Nigerian vaccine.
In respect to the legacy you have left, what are some of the medical and what are some of the challenges that medical personnel still go to and even students of this?
Well, the main challenge we're facing now is the COVID. We had a lockdown the whole of last year because students have to aggregate in the hostel. Because COVID infection, you know, it's accelerated by congregation. So we have a shutdown. Now we are bringing them in graduate school to have their exam. One thing we have learned with COVID
seen also before. Now we are the University of the part of the Roman University that has conducted all their semester exams digitally. You know, we bring in the students faces so that we don't have too many of them at the same time. By and large, the daughter-in-law that spoke with my classmate, she's a pediatric psychologist. She received training from the school as well.
So it's not from my part, but from my part. How does this infrastructural degree impact medical education?
That's the whole lecture. Let me tell you that example. Somebody gets knocked down. The hospital attendant or the surgeon there doesn't have the skills to manage the clinical case. The next thing that doctor will do is to refer the patient to either Lasso, Lagos, or Youth. He has to get there. And if the roads are bad, you can't get there. You can't, whatever it is, you may not survive the trip. So there's no way, or the vehicle, the ambulance that is supposed to bring him there, has issues with danger. So people don't think of it like that. They feel that the solution to everybody's problem is that you have to get to the hospital. Even those going abroad, you have to get to the airport if you are ill. If there's no vehicle or no doctor to lead you out to the airport, then going abroad will make no sense. So there is a tight line between infrastructure and medicine. And from the guest speaker's lecture, he said you don't have to wait for the infrastructure to be built, but you should plan lessons to ensure that you maintain
Thank you very much. Thank you so much.